your blood group O, you have no antigen on the red blood cell. Zero antigen. And the I should mention, when you are AB, you have AB antigen on the red blood cell, you have no antibodies in your serum. If you are O, you have no antigen on your blood cell, but you have both antibodies A and B in your serum. So, is AB a universal donor or a universal acceptor?
Universal acceptor.
Because you have no antibodies, you can accept any blood. You can accept the A blood, the B blood, the AB blood. It doesn't matter, or even the O blood. Now remember, when you are given a transfusion of blood, you're not just given blood that you extract from one individual. And basically what the Red Cross does is it takes your blood, it spins them down, gets rid of the serum, and then just takes the cells, resuspends them in synthetic serum, and then injects it into you. So it gets rid of all the antibodies that are present in your serum. So you only get red blood cells from an individual. You don't get serum from an individual. The serum is used to extract other things. Okay, so there are three alleles for the ABO group of genes. There is a gene called I, and there is an allele of this gene called IA. There is an allele called IB. And then there is an allele called little I. So three genes, four blood groups. So how does this work? Well, the IA enzyme synthesizes an enzyme that adds sugar A to the red blood cell protein. So this enzyme will attach a sugar that's called sugar A. The IB form of this enzyme will synthesize an enzyme that instead of adding sugar A will add sugar B onto the surface of the blood, of a particular protein in the blood, on the red blood cells. And then little I does not produce any enzyme. So when you are an A blood group, A blood type, you can be one of two forms. You can be IAIA, homozygous dominant, if you wish, and IA little I. Both in this instance, you're going to be producing this IA enzyme to attach the sugar A to the surface of the protein on the red blood cell. When you're B blood type, you also have two genotypes, IBIB and IB little I. When you are an AB individual, you are IAIB. You're producing both enzymes, and so half of the proteins on the red blood cell surface will be modified with the A antigen, and half will have the sugar, the B antigen. And so you will have both. So you're co-dominant at this point. And then for the A blood group, there is a single genotype, and that's little I. So you have these combinations, and these combinations result in the four different blood groups that we see. Question?
So why is O the most popular? The most common.
Which one?
Why is O the most common?
I honestly don't know. I don't know a lot about the blood groups, for example. The big question I have is, why do you have antibodies against these antigens in your serum? There are lots of questions I have. One day hoping I can get answers to, but at this point I don't know. And with regards to commonality of specific blood groups, it's probably something to do with geographical locations. And it goes into the area of population genetics, but I honestly don't know, so I'm not going to comment more on that. People have commented on the fact that you have antibodies against antigens of the opposite type, as of that it may be a way to protect you against cannibalism. But truthfully, it just doesn't sound right to me. So if you start eating a lot of human tissue, well maybe, right? No more donor parties. But it just doesn't make sense to me how that works. I mean, maybe, I don't know. But there are theories. You can read about these and papers in there. I've looked at a few. It just doesn't resonate with me, and so I've ignored them in this area. But I have questions as well, just like you. So for three alleles give you six genotypes and only four phenotypes, basically, and that's what you need to know. What you need to know is that every time you're analyzing these alleles, you're analyzing them in pairs. So look at them in pairs and ask which one is dominant and which one is recessive and which one is co-dominant. And based on that, you will be able to determine the phenotypes of these individuals. All right. So this is just showing you this reciprocal relationship, and the question biological significance of the relationship is not clear at this point, at least to me, which is in this individual, you have the A antigen and you have the B antibody. In this individual, you have the B antigen and the A antibody. In this individual, you have no antigens and you have the AB antibodies. And then in this individual, you have AB antigens but no antibodies. And so based on that, of course, you can say each one is a universal donor or a universal acceptor, etc. All right, so there we go. We're done with chapter 3, the section we want to study for the midterm. Epistasis and genetic pathways in chapter 3, which is most of 3-2, will be after the midterm. Just a small part of 3-2, which is multiple alleles, will be before the midterm or in the midterm. Everything else of 3-2 will be after the midterm, the genetic pathway section. Any questions? All right, so we've been talking so far about phenotypes that fluctuate and vary. And we basically, remember Mendel's relationship of phenotypes were very simple. There was a dominant allele and a mutant allele, a recessive allele in the heterozygous condition. That was all Mendel found. But we've now seen that there are many times when that relationship breaks down at the level of phenotype. You get incomplete dominance, you get co-dominance, you might have multiple alleles, and the relationship of phenotype varies depending on which combination of alleles you are studying. And the geographical conditions, the experimental conditions, all of these affect the phenotype in the heterozygous condition. And that's great, but I've always maintained until this point that the genotype that Mendel and the rules that Mendel discovered with respect to the genotypes don't fluctuate. The genotypes still move exactly the same way, correct? I've always maintained that until this point. Now we're going to look at something where the genes themselves don't follow Mendel's rules. So when you are studying two different genes, Mendel's law of independent assortment is, if you have gene A for a trait A and gene B for a trait B, let's imagine it's hair versus height. Okay? Those two genes for those two traits behave independently of one another. Correct? That's the law of independent assortment. Well, now I'm going to show you conditions where that law of independent assortment seems to break down. And then we're going to use that breakdown of that law to investigate aspects of chromosome structure. And that's what we're going to talk about, which is linkage. Okay, so here's, I'm doing a test cross, just showing you again Mendel's law of independent assortment. This is just in a sense a review for your winter. Okay, Mendel's law of independent assortment, consequence of the fact that chromosomes segregate independently of one another during meiosis. If you have two different chromosomes, those two chromosomes will segregate independently of one another during meiosis. So two individuals, one heterozygous and one homozygous recessive, and you're going to take those two individuals and cross them. So this is an effect, a test cross. At this point, when we are studying linkage and mapping, as you will see soon, we almost invariably do a test cross. Okay? So keep that in mind. Okay, so we're going to start with the heterozygous individual, big A little a, big B little b. We're going to cross it to a homozygous recessive, little a little b, little b. So gametes produced by this individual? Just one, correct? Gametes produced by this individual, four different types. Big A, big B. Little a, big B. Big A, little b. And little a, little b. And this individual produces one gamete, little a, little b. And now the gametes will fertilize each other, you'll get progeny. And that progeny ratio, in the progeny that's in this instance big A, little a, big B, little b. In this instance, little a, big B, little b. Here it's big A, little b, little b. And here it's little a, little b. Four different phenotype classes. And the ratio of those four classes is 1:1:1:1. Four different ratios, I mean four different classes, all approximately equal numbers. So 25%, 25%, 25%, 25%. That's your classic test cross for two genes in a Mendel, in a dihybrid cross, basically. Correct? Okay. So this is Mendel's law of independent assortment. Gene A and gene B segregate independently of one another. Assort independently of one another. Okay, the reason for it is in meiosis one. Chromosomes line up at the metaphase plate in meiosis one. And if you have two chromosomes, A and B, and you are a heterozygous individual for both of these chromosomes, you have a big A chromosome and a little A chromosome, you have a big B chromosome and a little B chromosome, you can line up like this, where you have big A and big B on the left, little A and little B chromosomes on the right. But alternatively, you can line up on the metaphase plate such that you have big A and little A chromosomes, big A and little B chromosomes on the left, and little A and big B chromosomes on the right. So, because you have two chromosomes, two totally different chromosomes, can line up in two different ways, and you're heterozygous for both of these chromosomes, you end up with four different kinds of gametes. You end up with gametes that are big A and big B, little a and little b, or you end up with gametes that are big A, little b, and little a, big b. So four different kinds of gametes. And in the population of gametes, this class of gametes will be 25%, this class of gametes will be 25%, this class will be 25%, and this class will be 25%. Right? So this is the basis for Mendel's law of independent assortment. And A and the B genes, if you imagine instead of chromosomes A and B represent genes on these different chromosomes. If you imagine there is a gene A, big A and little a, and another gene, gene B, big B and little b, then you'll see that these genes also assort independently of one another because they're on totally different chromosomes, right? And so they will behave. So now, let's do a couple of crosses. Okay. We're going to start a cross where we are big A, big A, big B, big B. Homozygous big A, big B, cross to homozygous little a, little b. You always try to start a cross with a homozygous parent, like Mendel taught us with true breeding states, correct? You start with a true breeding parent, that's big A, big B. Cross it to a true breeding parent, that's little a, little b. Simultaneously, you start another cross. You start a cross where you are homozygous big A, homozygous little b, cross to a parent that's homozygous little a, homozygous big b. Okay? So you're going to do two different crosses in this condition. Okay. So, you're going to do a cross that big A, big B, cross to little a, little b. Or we're going to do a cross that big A, little b, cross to little a, big b. So when you do this cross, what's the F1 going to look like? The heterozygous individual will be big A, big B, little a, little b. Correct? Big A, little a, big B, little b. If you do this cross, you're also going to get a parent. Are you going to get a progeny? that's going to be big A, little a, big B, little a. Correct? So irrespective of what cross you do, you're going to get an individual that's going to be heterozygous A, heterozygous B. Clear so far? No problems, correct? Okay, now you're going to do a test cross with this heterozygous individual. What do you have? So this heterozygous individual is going to produce four different kinds of gametes based on the way these chromosomes will line up at the metaphase plate. And you can have big A and big B on one side, little a and little b on one side, or you can have big A and little b on one side and little a and big b on the other side, and you end up with four gametes. So now if I do a test cross with this heterozygous individual that was generated by this parent. So the original parents were big A, big B, crossed to little a, little b. I generated this heterozygous condition. I took this heterozygous strain, crossed it to a homozygous recessive. That's my test cross, okay? And I'm going to fill out this Punnett square. This parent here produces a single kind of gamete. That's going to be little a, little b. But this parent here, big A, big B, little b, the heterozygous parent, is going to produce four kinds of gametes. Big A, big B, little a, big B, big A, little b, and little a, little b. Four different gametes. They will get fertilized at random, and you get four different phenotype progeny in the F2. Big A, big B, little b, little a, big B, little b, big A, little a, little b, little b, and little a, little b. Saw this earlier, and the ratios of course will be 25%, 25%, 25%, 25%, all four. But let's imagine you did this cross. You started with this cross, big A, little b, cross to little a, big b. You generated an F1 individual, that's big A, little a, big b, little b. And now you're going to do a test cross with those individuals. So here's your test cross. Here's the heterozygous individual produced from this cross here. You're crossing it to a little a, little b parent. One gamete plus. Four different gametes produced by this heterozygous parent. F1 progeny, big A, little b, little a, big b, big A, little b, little a, little b. The F2's progeny will look like this, and the ratios are 25%, 25%. So, it doesn't matter what the genotype of the parents were. It could have been big A, big B, crossed to little a, little b, or big A, little b, crossed to little a, little big b. You still get the same progeny in the F2. Correct? Yes? No problems, correct? Clear so far. The reason for this is because A and B are on two totally different molecules or chromosomes. Totally different DNA molecules, totally different chromosomes. And this chromosome behaves totally independently of this chromosome. They assort independently from one another. And so it doesn't matter what your original parents were, you're going to get the same result. But now, what happens if these markers are on the same chromosome? Okay. Remember, I've told you there are many genes on a single chromosome. It's not like there's only a single gene on a single chromosome. This chromosome, the gray chromosome, can have the A gene, and it might have another gene, C, it might have a gene D, whatever, right? So what happens when you have two different genes for two different traits on the same chromosome? So, let's imagine there are two genes, A and C. Okay. Let's say A gives you tall and little a gives you short. Big C gives you cream and little c gives you white. And we are now going to do two different crosses. We're going to start with an individual, tall and cream, big A, big C, cross to an individual that's short and white, little a, little c. That's one cross we're going to do. The second cross simultaneously that we're going to do, we're going to start with a true breeding parent, That's tall and white. Big A, little c. Cross to an individual that's short and green. Little a, big C. So, this individual cross will produce a heterozygous F1. And this heterozygous F1 will be tall and green. Because we'll get the big A from this, little a from here, big C from here, little c from here, and they'll be tall and green. In this cross, they'll also be tall and green, because we'll get the big A from here, and the little a from here, little c from here, and the big C from here. You're both heterozygous and you're both tall and green. Now you do a test cross with these heterozygous individuals. The heterozygous individual, homozygous recessive, because you remember a test cross is a heterozygous to a homozygous recessive. Cross it to a homozygous recessive, little a, little c, in both instances, which is short and white. And you ask what happens. And here's what you see. I'm giving you the results of this cross. What you find is you get 50% tall and green, 50% short and white in this cross. And in this cross here, you get 50% tall and white, 50% short and green. So unlike the previous crosses that we were doing, in this example, you're not getting four different F2 classes. You're only getting two F2 classes. In this instance, you're getting a class that's tall and green that looks like this parent, and a class that's short and white that looks like this parent in the F2. In this cross, you're getting 50% tall and white that looks like this parent, 50% short and green that looks like this parent. So in this cross now, the F2 progenies look like the original parents. So how the genes were brought into the cross determines the results of the cross, the F2 progeny. These genes, tall and green, are linked. They are held together all the time. They don't seem to be assorting independently of one another. According to Mendel, this tall and this green gene should have assorted independently, and you should have gotten four different progeny classes in the F2. Tall green, short white, tall white, and short green. And you don't see those four classes. You only see the two classes, and those two classes look exactly like the two classes that were present in the original parental genotypes. Yes? So, these are linked genes. They've kind of been held together all the time. And they're not assorting independently of one another. So what's going on? So in these crosses, independent assortment is not occurring. This is now genes that are not assorting separately, individually from one another. Nothing to do with phenotypes, it's genes. Okay? In the first cross, tall and green behave as though they are linked to one another. In the second cross, tall and white appear to be linked to one another. And the results are explained by the fact that these two genes are present on the same physical molecule. There's a single molecule of DNA from one end of a chromosome to another, and if those two genes are on the same molecule of DNA, they will be linked. They will be on the same physical molecule, and so you can move together in this way, right? So, I'm going to draw this out now. Here is a single chromosome. Here is the original cross, big A, big C, homozygous parent, cross to the chromosome that little a and little c, homozygous chromosome. In the F1, you get a heterozygous individual, that's big A, big C, little a, little c. And you're going to then cross it to a, little c individual. You're going to do a test cross. This individual will produce a single kind of gamete, and this individual will produce two kinds of gametes. Remember in meiosis one, you get segregation of these chromosomes, so big A and big C will go to one pole, little a and little c will go to another pole. You'll get two kinds of gametes, one that has big A, big C, and one that has little a, little c. and they will now produce F2 progeny that are dark green or short and white. And that's your 50% dark green, 50% short and white. Two genes go together, they are linked all the way through. Right? So now let's look at the other cross, the second cross we did. In the second cross, we started with a parent that's tall and white. And we crossed it to a parent that was short and green, little a with C. In the F1, you're heterozygous phenotypically, but when you look on the chromosomes are slightly different. You have the big A linked to the little C, and you have the little a linked to the big C. Now these chromosomes in meiosis 1 will separate. Cross it to a little a little c. We're going to produce gametes that are going to be big A little c or little a big c. And then you're going to produce progeny that are tall and white or short and white. Yes? And so that's the underlying reason for why you saw the linked genes. You don't see the other two classes because to get the other two classes, you would have to somehow separate these two genes along the DNA. You have to cut them in half and separate. Right? Clear? Okay. This is a theoretical condition. What I've just given you is a representation of something that only happens in theory. That just happens so I can explain to you how two genes should be linked and behave. So, if you have the original test cross with two genes on two different chromosomes, you get four classes, big A, big B, little a, little b, big A, little b, and little a, big b. And you get four kinds of progeny, like this. And the ratios are 25, 25, 25, 25. If you are big A, big C cross to little a, little c, get a heterozygous big A little C, do a test cross, that the genes A and C are on the same chromosome. When you do that, you get progeny classes in this crisscross that look like the parents. Big A, big C looking like this parent 50%, little a, little c looking like this parent 50%, and these two classes are similar. The genes on the same chromosome, they will have reduced or no, none of these classes missing. Okay? So notice what happens in the test cross. If the genes are on different chromosomes, you get a ratio that goes 1, 1, 1, 1, 25%, 25%, 25%, 25%. If two genes are on the same chromosome, you get two classes that are 50% each. And two classes that are missing. So when you see a change in ratio in a test cross for two different genes, it indicates that the genes are linked. If you see this ratio, that means the two genes are on different chromosomes. If you see something that looks like this, that will mean that the two genes are on the same chromosome. So when you do a test cross, look for these ratios. And if the ratios don't follow this rule, then by definition, the two genes are on the same chromosome and they are said to be linked. Okay? Clear? Okay, so we will take a break here and then we'll actually look at the results that were generated by Morgan again for two genes on the same chromosome. We'll look at the real results rather than the hypothetical theoretical results. To find out the genotype.
Yeah.